What is up? I just had a chai tea. I'm so ready to film this video right now. Welcome back to Life from Mars. It is your girl Marissa. I'm here, of course, with another video today for you guys. And today, I am actually going to be doing something that I have never done before, okay? Because today, we are going to be unraveling a true crime unsolved mystery. I'm so excited. You guys know that I absolutely love mysteries. That's totally my vibe, but I've actually never done a true crime episode before. And so I could not be happier that today's gonna be the first one. So I got this story from Unsolved Mysteries, which is currently streaming on Netflix. If you guys have not seen it, the second season just premiered and it is number one trending on Netflix right now, okay? And they feature some absolutely insane mysteries. And when I say insane, I really do mean insane, all right? Every episode is different and they're not all true crime, but some of them are, and they are just mind-boggling, guys. We are about to dive into the details of this case, but before I go into it, I just want to let you guys know that I am actually planning on doing a series of all the unsolved mystery episodes for season two. So I'm going to make an episode for each episode, so stay tuned. I'm going to break all these mysteries down for you guys, and we're going to discuss. I'm going to tell you guys some of my theories, what I thought as I was watching it, what I think afterwards, what I think now, and of course you guys can let me know what you think as well. So let's just get into it. So this story starts when a body is found in a landfill in Wilmington, Delaware, okay? So this body is found, it's seen early in the morning by the people who work at this landfill, and they go up to it, you know, they see that it's a man who's on top of a pile of trash, and of course they immediately call the police. So this man is wearing a white shirt, he's wearing black pants, and he has something else that's like a black apparel that's covering the top of his chest, okay? And the most notable thing about this man, however, was the ring that he had on his finger. It was a gigantic, huge, nice class ring from West Point Academy. And so if you guys don't know what West Point Academy is, it's pretty much the most prestigious, well-known military academy in the United States, okay? So later that same day, the body was identified, and it was found that it was John Jack Wheeler. So John Wheeler, or he usually went by Jack Wheeler, was a very, very prestigious person, all right? This man had military insides. He had worked as a White House aide under Bush. He was the assistant to the Secretary of the Air Force. Not only did this man go to West Point Academy, but he also went to Harvard Business School and Yale Law School, all right? So we are talking about a very prominent man, a man with a lot of very serious contacts in the government, in business, etc., in the military. I mean, this guy had top level clearance. You know, he had worked on a multitude of projects. In fact, he was also the executive director of the Vietnam Memorial because he actually served in Vietnam himself. So this man had dedicated a good portion of his career and his political and government workings to actually trying to advocate for veterans. He believed, you know, that they lacked some things, that, you know, he wanted to provide more resources and accessibility to certain things for veterans. So that was a really big thing that he particularly worked on during his life. As far as his personal life, Jack was married. He was married to a woman named Catherine, or Kathy Kyle. She had two kids and he also had two kids, and they all lived together, and they described a very loving, caring environment. You know, the kids, her kids as well, had only glowing things to say about Jack. She also said wonderful things about him, you know, just went on and on about how he was so passionate and about how he did so many good things and he was always trying to help people, and that he was overall just a very loving, you know, husband and father. And along with that, Jack also did personally struggle with mental illness. He was actually diagnosed with bipolar disorder, and so that was something that he was battling throughout his life. Now, they did say that he was pretty good about taking his medication and that he did have obviously good control over it. But from time to time, you know, he did have moments where the mental illness was a little bit more difficult to manage. So at the time of his death, though, Jack was actually working as a consultant for a company called the Mitre Corporation. So the Mitre Corporation is actually a defense agency, okay? So they do defense contracting. Basically, that means that they do contracting for different services that they offer for the military, for defense operations, for wars, etc., right? So they specialized in AI technology, they did satellites for military, and Jack was specifically working in the section of cybersecurity, all right? So in the show, they give the comparison of like what he would be working on today would be, let's just say, the fact that Russia supposedly hacked the US election, right? So those are the kind of very serious, very really intense cybersecurity things that he had been working on. So despite knowing his identity and knowing all this, the biggest problem with this was that, yes, his body was found in the landfill, but first of all, there was no clear signs of assault, and his body had been beat up. It was clear that he had been, like, you know, assaulted in some way, but he did not have any gunshot wounds, he did not have any stab wounds, or any obvious signs of how he could have been killed. Additionally to that, there was absolutely no suspects, and they did not understand how or why this man had ended up dead in this landfill. His family were shocked. So many of his colleagues were shocked. And as they began to find out more and more information about the days leading up to his death, things just got even crazier, guys, all right? So basically, I'm gonna go through the timeline of what happened, and you're just gonna see how this just starts to unravel, and there really is just so many more questions than there are answers. So on December 31st, 2020, Jack's body is found in the landfill. After the police showed up, this was obviously a crime scene, even though it was a landfill and miles away from their traditional crime scene, as many of them would also say, they still had to try and collect any evidence that may be there in the landfill. You know, they wanted to see if they could find a cell phone, a wallet, you know, any proof as to where he had been or maybe who he had been with or what had happened to him. And they did not find anything. But like I said, his body was able to be identified that same day that they found him. And so they found out that this was John Jack Wheeler, and they ended up finding out that he had a residence in Newcastle, Delaware. So at that point, they phoned the Newcastle Police Department and they let them know, you know, we have this man who's been murdered, he has a property there, can you please send some officers to his house? And they ended up finding out during that phone call that actually police officers were already on their way to Jack's house, because there had been a call about a possible burglary. So this is where things start getting complicated, guys, okay? So basically, Jack was often out of this house, and so he actually had a neighbor that acted pretty much as the caretaker for the home, okay? So he was always traveling. His wife, Kathy, also had another home where she would kind of stay with her kids. And so as far as I understand, I feel like Jack was primarily the one living at this home. I feel like Kathy would sometimes go, but Jack was just always busy. He was pretty much a workaholic, and so he really wasn't even home much in the first place. And he was always going back and forth to Washington, Delaware, where he had this home, and then Kathy's home in New York. So he had this neighbor who he had set up, you know, a situation where he's basically just saying, you know, just watch over the house for me. So on this same day, the same day that his body is found in the landfill on December 31st, the neighbor had noticed that there was a window open on the second floor of his house. So he thought, you know, obviously I'm the caretaker, you know, he wanted to go check things out, he had a key, so he went and he let himself into the house. Now the first thing that he noticed as he walked in the house was that the second door was open, it was like slightly open. The storm door, the first door, right, was closed, but the actual door was open slightly. So he walks in, and as soon as he walks in, it's pretty obvious that there was something wrong here, okay? He basically described the house as if it was in turmoil. There was broken dishes in the sink. Things had been knocked over and thrown onto the ground. There were spices everywhere, just spice bottles and spices just sprayed all over the kitchen. And there was a huge pile of white powder, which he thought was the cleaning supply Comet, because there was a nearby bottle of that. And on top of that, but what I think is honestly the craziest thing that he saw about this whole scene, and the thing that just really just even makes it even stranger, is that in all of this chaos, underneath that comment that had fell on the floor, was Jack's ceremonial West Point sword and shield. All right, so these probably prized possessions, I would assume, a sword and a shield that were ceremonial things from West Point, were just laying on the floor in the kitchen underneath this comment. The neighbor would also say that he additionally felt like he saw footprints, bare footprints, he said, in that comment as well, okay? So you can just imagine, the neighbor walks in, he sees this whole scene, and he's just like, I think something's wrong here. So of course, he ends up contacting the police, and he tells them that he thinks that there's been a burglary. And the other strange thing about this whole situation is that just a couple days before this happened, before the burglary, before Jack's body was found, there had been someone who had set off smoke bombs in the house across the street, okay? And so the house across the street was actually under construction. So this house had been under construction, and Jack actually did not approve of this house being under construction at all, okay? He lived on this street, which was supposedly a very historic street, and he just could not fathom the idea that someone was building a brand new home in this historic neighborhood, okay? And so he was actually trying to stop the homeowners from being able to build this house. But just a couple of days before his body was found, smoke bombs were set off in this house, all right? And so police were already investigating that when they came upon Jack's situation and, you know, came to investigate the burglary and obviously murder as well. They were never able to find out who actually set off those smoke bombs, but what the crazy thing is, they found a cell phone at that site, okay? At the neighbor's house across the street, when they were investigating the smoke bomb incident, they found a cell phone. And the cell phone belonged to Jack Wheeler. Now you might be asking yourself, all right, so what's going on? Like, there was a burglary, there was some weird situation going on in the kitchen, his sword is on the floor, his body's found in a landfill, there was a smoke bomb in the house across the street, and his cell phone was there. Yeah, it's complicated, and I'm basically gonna piece it all together for you guys so you can see that that's just, you know, that's just cracking the surface, all right? I'm just giving you some framework for all the insanity that is about Twin Soup, all right? So take in mind, because Jack was such a high profile individual, because he had had ties with the White House and the Pentagon, a lot of federal agencies were called in to investigate this case, okay? Including the FBI. In fact, in the show, they actually said that there was at least 10 different federal, state, and local agencies that were investigating his death, okay? And still to this day, it is such a big mystery. So that alone should just let you guys know how insane the situation is. So basically the rest of the episode, they go on to reconstruct, or try to best reconstruct as they can, Jack's final days, because that was the only way that they could think to try to find an answer as to what had happened to him. So remember that Jack's body is found on December 31st. So we're gonna lead up to that point and kind of go back in time and see what he was doing in the days previous. So during Christmas and in the first few days after Christmas, Jack was with his family. He was with Kathy and his children for Christmas, and he spent the next couple days with them as well. And apparently he was actually supposed to stay there quite a few days longer, but ended up telling Kathy that he was going to have to leave to go to DC early, okay? So he left New York, where Kathy's home was, on the morning of December 28th. So his wife was actually quite upset that he was leaving so early, because again, you know, they had made plans, they were supposed to go to the movies, they were supposed to do some different things, and so she was kind of upset that he was leaving so soon after Christmas. But at the same time, she knew that this was just how Jack was. You know, he was a workaholic, he was always working, he had 15 different projects going on at the same time. And so, you know, she just kind of wasn't happy about it, but obviously there wasn't really anything that she could do about it. So the first thing that police were able to use to track his movements after he left Kathy's house on the 28th that morning was his cell phone. So everyone basically says that Jack was someone that was on his phone all the time. Obviously, like I said, he was a workaholic, so he was constantly, you know, communicating with people from his business, from people that he was working with, and also with his family, because he didn't really get to, you know, again, spend that much time with him. So he was always in regular contact with them, as well as his other business associates. So according to his phone records, he did take a train from New York to DC, and it seems that he only spent part of the day working, and at the end of the day, on that same day, on the 28th, he actually ended up leaving DC for an unknown reason. So later that day, when he left Washington, he actually ended up going to Newcastle, Delaware, back to his home there, right? So this is the same home that the neighbor had been watching, and walked in and saw this chaotic scene, all right? So this is the same house, but a couple of days before. And the smoke bomb incident happened that same night, all right? So the same night that Jack just so happens to leave Washington to go back to Newcastle, that is the same night that that smoke bomb incident took place, all right? So the next day after that is where things just start to get a little bit weird. First things first, his wife starts to try to contact him in the morning of that day. And she's trying to call him, she's sending him texts, but she cannot contact him. And she thinks that that's kind of unusual, because again, Jack was someone that lived on his phone. It was very, very important to him. Like, that was vital. He always had it with him. And so she finds it very strange, and it was very uncharacteristic to him that he wasn't answering her, that he was just giving her no reply whatsoever. So later it was found that on that same morning, on December 29th, Jack had actually sent an email to his employer, the Mitre Corporation. He said that he had been burglarized and that someone had actually come in and taken multiple of his things, It included his wallet, his cell phone, his briefcase, which included multiple things from his job, like his key tags, security clearances, all of these important things that he had, his key fob, and his badge for work as well. So he sends this email to his job, but for some unknown reason, even though he's claiming that he was burglarized, he did not contact the police. And obviously, again, this is one of those questions in the case that nobody really understands, but for some reason, he just didn't contact them. So after he loses his phone, this is where it becomes a lot more difficult to track him, right? Because they don't really have any way of knowing where he went other than eyewitness accounts, which can be flawed. Obviously, you know, he could have been misidentified. And the only thing that they really know for sure is when they caught him on CCTV footage going to different places. So after he sends this email on the early morning of the 29th, the next time Jack is seen is at 6 p.m. on the 29th, entering a local pharmacy that he would often go to around his house. So he goes into this pharmacy and he's telling everyone that he's looking for a ride to Wilmington. So he was trying to get there because he had actually left his car in Wilmington, all right? So before he went to New York, before he took the train to New York to go with Kathy, he'd actually left his car in Wilmington, Delaware. So he's asking employees and different people around the CVS, you know, if anyone can give him a ride because he didn't have a car. And eventually someone offers, and so he's seen leaving the pharmacy with a man. At 6:42, so 42 minutes after he's seen entering the pharmacy, he is seen again on CCTV footage from a garage in Wilmington. But the problem is, this garage was not the garage that his car was parked in. His car was actually parked in a garage that was blocks away from where he was. The people that know him said that this was actually very common for him to do. He often forgot where he left things, and this actually wasn't even the first time that he forgot where he parked his car. They even said that he would go to work in his car and then come home taking, you know, a taxi because he couldn't remember where he had left his car. But the strangest thing about this was that the man that is seen on the CCTV footage from the parking garage seems to be in a completely different mental state and is acting completely differently than the man who entered the pharmacy just 14 minutes before, okay? When he entered the pharmacy, he seemed very relaxed, you know, he was in a good mood, he was smiling, he was being very casual, and when he's in the parking garage, the footage of him talking to the attendants and walking around, he seems paranoid, he seems agitated, he seems distressed. He actually had one shoe off, all right? So he's holding one shoe in his hand and one shoe's on his foot. He's telling the attendant that he doesn't know where his car is and that the actual parking ticket was left in his briefcase, which again, was supposedly stolen, okay? And so apparently, according to the attendant, he's telling her, you know, I don't have the ticket. It's in my briefcase, it's in my briefcase. And she's like, okay, well, where's your briefcase, right? So he tells her, well, I don't have it, it was stolen. And she asks him, how is it stolen? What happened? And he just keeps saying, it was stolen. Like, he won't elaborate any more than that because he obviously, I guess, just doesn't want to or can't, whatever, right? So again, he's just walking around, he's very distressed, he's trying to find his car, he doesn't know what to do, and it seems very obvious that he's acting very paranoid, okay? So he's looking over his shoulder. Before he walks in a doorway, he's kind of looking over the corner, and you know, his family would describe after seeing that footage that it obviously seemed like he was acting as if he was being watched or like he was being followed, you know? And some people theorize that perhaps in that 42 minutes time span that he was taken from Newcastle to Wilmington, that possibly he was assaulted in some way or something happened that caused him to be so shaken up when he arrived at the parking garage. People also think that, you know, maybe because he was walking on one foot, he had taken his shoe off, maybe something had happened to his foot. You know, no one really knew. Obviously, he was alone when he entered the parking garage, theoretically, because, you know, he's not seen with anyone else. Now, some people do also theorize that possibly Jack had some kind of mental breakdown. Like I did mention previously, he did suffer with bipolar disorder. And so some people think, you know, maybe he was just having a really bad episode. Maybe something happened that triggered it. And, you know, he was just having some psychosis of some sort. But again, there's just really no way to know for sure. And you know, his wife does say that it's possible, but again, he was very diligent again about taking his medication. He did have outbursts here and there, and you know, he did have like mood swings and some more minor issues, I guess you could say, but he had never had a full-blown meltdown, and that was just completely uncharacteristic for people who had known him for decades and decades. So to me, that doesn't really seem like it's very likely or even plausible. but it is obviously possible, so it can't be ruled out as a possible explanation. So after all the strange behavior, Jack ends up leaving the parking garage at some point, and he's actually not caught on camera until 20 hours later. So again, no one knows what happened in that 20-hour time span. And now we are on December 30th, alright? So this is just a day before his body is found in the landfill the next morning, alright? So this is the day where obviously something went very, very wrong. So on December 30th, he is actually spotted on camera in the basement of an office complex building. This building was called the Nemours Building, and it was in downtown Wilmington. It was later found that Jack had spent the night and a large part of the day there. So assumingly, that's where he spent the majority of these 20 hours. So this basement area of this huge office complex building had so many hallways, so many tunnels, there was locker rooms, there was rooms, there were so many different access points. I mean, it was a huge building. And this underground complex was pretty much a maze of its own. So there really was no way for them to even know exactly what Jack was really doing down there or where he was even at. Some employees would say that they found some things in the stairwell that they thought looked like someone may have slept there. But when investigators went back to this building to try to find some trace of Jack, there was just nothing that could definitively be linked to him. So again, they just still didn't really know why he was there, because also he had no connections to this building, or at least no known connections. No one could really understand why he would have gone to this building and why he would have been in this basement. It was obvious that he was trying to hide from something. I definitely think it is a little bit strange that he wouldn't just get a hotel. So, I mean, again, this just, you know, nothing really, I guess, makes sense. People did theorize, though, that Jack just probably was trying to find somewhere where he could kind of lay low until he could find a quiet and safe way out of town. People did mention that he apparently at one point was looking for a ride to Philadelphia, so the leading theory is that he was trying to get out of that city without being noticed, you know? Obviously, he was hiding from someone. Obviously, potentially, whoever had stolen his items, you know, the day before, he was probably assumingly afraid of those people or, you know, that individual, whoever that person was. And so he was kind of trying to hide from them and also try to find an escape. So at 8:30 p.m. on December 30th, the day before his body is found in the landfill, Jack was seen for the last time on camera, and this is the last footage that they would ever catch of him alive. So he's seen leaving the Nemours Building, and now he's wearing a black hoodie, okay? This was not his hoodie as far as anyone recognized. He had never worn it before, so I can only assume that maybe he took it from one of the employee lockers or, you know, something like that. Maybe just found it somewhere and thought, you know, this could help disguise me. So he walks out wearing his black pants and the black hoodie. He has the hoodie over his head, all right? And it's so obvious when you see him on the camera that he is clearly trying to hide from something, you know? I mean, this guy is literally looking down, completely covered with the hoodie. He's looking around kind of cautiously, but also just trying not to be noticed. You know, it's very, very obvious, in my opinion, that he was hiding from someone. So yeah, those final camera shots basically caught him walking through the valet and then down the street. And after that, they really don't know for sure what happened. But again, the next day on December 31st, his body would be found in the morning at the landfill in Wilmington. However, where this case gets even more perplexing is the fact that it was found that the trash that was around Jack's body, so obviously the dumpster that he had been dumped into, was actually not even from Wilmington, even though that was the last place that he was known to be. It was from Newark, Delaware. So Newark, Delaware is actually 40 miles away from Wilmington. So it is not known how Jack got from Wilmington to Newark and why he was even in Newark, because it's explainable that he would go to Wilmington because his car was there, right? That did make sense. But there was no reason that he would have gone to Newark. Even his wife was totally confused and to this day has no idea why he would have gone to Newark, because he literally had no ties there. And on top of that, when he was seen walking away from the building, he was even walking in the opposite direction of where Newark was, okay? So just none of this made sense. They were eventually, after tracing the garbage, not only did they find out that it was from Newark, but they were able to find what truck it was on, and after that, they were able to basically pinpoint a couple of dumpsters that they thought his body might have been in. So from that point, they sent in forensic teams and they were basically going in and swabbing all these dumpsters to try to find any trace of him. And in one of the dumpsters, they actually ended up finding a partial DNA match for Jack Wheeler. So at that point, they were pretty confident that his body probably was disposed of, or that at some point he had been in this dumpster and then that's how he had ended up in the Wilmington landfill. Now again, it is still not known how Jack got from Wilmington to Newark. So there was one witness that supposedly said that they split a taxi with Jack and that he wanted to split the taxi when he heard that it was going to Newark because that's where he was trying to go. Now, it is not known whether this was actually Jack or not, because again, it could have been another man that had just been misidentified as Jack. A lot of the times, witness testimonies cannot necessarily be 100% trusted because they don't really always remember things as they think they would. And you know, there's a lot of science around it, but it's just, it obviously cannot be presented as valid factual evidence. So the trash truck drivers did say that it was actually fairly common that they would find people sleeping or, you know, just hanging out in these dumpsters. Especially in the middle of winter, it would be very likely that someone who would just be on the street would climb inside and, you know, just try to get some warmth and get away from the winter. Obviously, we're talking about December 31st, so it's, you know, it's literally the middle of the winter and it's very cold in Delaware. So there was a theory that Jack possibly could have just kind of wandered into this dumpster again, you know, just trying to find somewhere warm to sleep. But the main issue with that theory is that when they did the autopsy, his death was ruled a homicide. It was proven that he was beaten to death. And so it is seen as much more likely that he was killed and then he was placed in the dumpster. He was supposed to go to the landfill. He was never supposed to be found. That was very obvious. So although it is technically possible that he could have climbed in there on his own, it just does not seem likely considering the fact that he was beaten to death. Or more specifically, his death was ruled as a result of blunt force trauma. And by the way, I even did think, well, maybe he fell, you know, into the dumpster truck and, you know, he just got knocked up a bunch and maybe he just died during that process. But according to the scientists and the people that investigated this case, that is just not, that's not possible, and that the injuries that he had are not consistent with just a fall into a dumpster truck. So it's very obvious that these had to have been inflicted before he entered the dumpster. Jack actually had several pretty severe injuries. He had fractured ribs, he had a collapsed lung, he had bruises everywhere, he had a contusion to his head. So again, it was very clear that something bigger had happened to him. But it is unknown why he was beaten or by who. Some people think, you know, maybe it could have just been some random person on the street. Was he just in the wrong place at the wrong time and just happened to get killed by some random person on the street? But that doesn't seem very likely either because, you know, the investigators were basically saying that usually when something like that happens, they're just gonna leave the body there. They're not gonna go and try to cover it up. They're not gonna go and drag this, you know, grown man, 200 plus pound man, to the dumpster and try to dispose of his body. If something happens and there's an altercation on the street, maybe he was jumped or something, that person is gonna run and they're gonna leave him there, right? That's what usually happens. You only usually see this kind of thing happening when it's a planned, you know, hit, when they're actually trying to really dispose of this person in every sense of the word. So now knowing this, obviously you have to go back to what happened to his house, right? The burglary, when his stuff is supposedly stolen, the things that his neighbor saw in Newcastle, right? So just to add another layer of complexity to this, you know how I mentioned that Jack was actually against the construction of the house across the street? Well, he was actually in a legal battle with those homeowners, okay? He was not just like actively against it. I mean, he was literally legally fighting to not have this home built, and he was very, very passionate about it. It really riled him up. So for that reason, there is some speculation that it could have been Jack himself that set off those smoke bombs, all right? And that that also could have explained why his cell phone was found at the scene. A theory that's presented in the series is that, you know, maybe when he got back to his house, he realized that his phone, it was gone and that he had dropped it. And so he started freaking out, and that's why he just started throwing all of the stuff randomly everywhere. You know, maybe at this point he was starting to again have kind of like that mental break. You know, maybe that was the start of his paranoia or, you know, his bipolar episode. No one really knows for sure, but that is a theory that he set off these smoke bombs, somehow lost his phone in the process, came home, and then started having a breakdown after realizing his phone was gone, and maybe for other reasons that are, again, unknown. However, that does not explain what happened to his other things, all right? And take in mind that the things that were stolen, not his cell phone, although he did lose his cell phone, that obviously wasn't stolen, but his wallet, his key card, his briefcase, most importantly, all of his information for his business, the cybersecurity things that he had been working on. I mean, you can imagine that there would be a lot of people who would probably want access to these things. So it doesn't necessarily make sense that if he said that those things were stolen, and they know for a fact that they were, because by the way, they never found that briefcase. They searched everywhere for that briefcase and they never found it. All these 10 different agencies trying to research this case and they still never found that briefcase. So they do know for a fact that in the very least, those items were probably stolen. But again, did those same people make the mess in his house or was that Jack? Are those things related or are they not? Again, there's just all these questions because no one really knows. And another very strange thing about it is that Jack also had several other things that were not stolen that you would think typically in a normal burglary would be, like his Rolex or his gold West Point ring or his cash that he had on him. All of those things were not taken. His wallet was taken, but again, he had a lot of identification and different documents in there that could have also been of interest to somebody. And that's pretty much where the case goes cold, guys. No one really knows anything other than that. They know that all of these things were going on simultaneously. They know that his house was found and it looked like it had been burglarized, but they don't know if that was also caused by the same people that supposedly took his things or if that was done by Jack himself. Was the smoke bomb done by Jack himself or was that somebody else? Are those things at all related to what later happened to him or the robbery? And of course, once again, who was it that took his things? And more importantly even, was that person or those people, that agency, whatever, was that the same entity that was stalking him, allegedly? Was that the person that he seemed to be running from? Was that the person that went on to kill him? Obviously, all of these questions remain, and most people do seem to think that yes, those things were related. Jack was being followed by somebody. His family believes this, that, you know, it was orchestrated, it was planned, it was a planned hit, and somebody, for some reason, wanted him gone. So Jack was eventually honored. He had a full military funeral. He was laid to rest. And obviously he is remembered very fondly by many people, by his family, his friends, his coworkers, the people that he engaged with in his life. And his memory will live on in a positive light. At the moment, it is pretty much assumed that there has to be people that know more than they are letting on to. And that until somebody comes forward with more actual credible information, there probably will be no more answers. So yeah, guys, this case is absolutely crazy. I mean, I was watching this and I don't know. I definitely also believe that it was for sure planned. I think that seems obvious. I mean, they took this briefcase that he was described to have carried everywhere with him. They said that he never went on an international trip without that briefcase. I mean, he had it with him 24/7. So I can only imagine what kind of things he had in that briefcase. I mean, think about this, guys. This is a guy with top military clearance, worked in the White House, worked for the Pentagon, worked for the highest level people in the government. And at first I thought, you know, maybe this was an inside job, you know, maybe someone within those departments wanted him gone, maybe he learned about something he wasn't supposed to learn about. But I do think it's interesting when we consider that he was working in cybersecurity, because I mean, if you think about it, if this is a man who's, let's just say, investigating like Russia's interference with the election, there could also be other entities internationally, whoever they may be, that could potentially also want him off, you know? So, I mean, it's almost impossible, I think, to narrow it down without knowing exactly what he was working on, but obviously the Mitre Corporation is not going to release that information. I'm sure that it is classified. So, yeah, there's just no really way to know. But it is interesting, again, to think about the fact that there was all these federal agencies that did have probably the right to know that information that still don't know the answer. So, yeah, it's just so perplexing. It really doesn't make that much sense at all. And again, like, all of these circumstances are so complicated, but it just makes even more questions, you know? What happened between the time that he went to the pharmacy and went to Wilmington and was suddenly all distressed? Why did he leave New York early? Did he already know something was going on after Christmas happened? And is that why he left his wife early, you know? Is that why he went to DC? And what was he doing in DC that one day that he worked? Did he go back to his home in Newcastle just so he could set off the smoke bomb in his neighbor's house? Was he really having a bipolar episode and just kind of having a mental break? And was that related to the situation? Is that what got him killed? Or did he already have something coming to him? Was his paranoia a result of his mental health? Or was it a result of somebody actually stalking him and obviously, you know, going to kill him? I don't know, guys, but I would absolutely love to hear your theories. Please let me know in the comments down below. If you haven't already seen the episode, I highly recommend you watch it. I did pretty much summarize everything up for you, but obviously it's really awesome to be able to see the visuals and all of that. So if you have Netflix, I would highly recommend that you check it out. It is just insane, guys. It is really, really unfortunate that this had to happen to him, and you know, it is just kind of cruel and unfair, but it is obviously good that his memory lives on in a positive way, that his family and his colleagues and his friends remember him in a very fond light. And you know, I don't think that obviously he deserved to die. No one deserves to be killed like that. And I can only imagine what kind of things that he was involved in that caused things to be escalated to that level. You know, who knows? We may never know, but I do hope, and I think that obviously this is the intention as well, is that by seeing this, you know, people, millions of people are going to be able to see this story on Netflix and hear about this, and it's going to be getting so much more exposure that possibly maybe someone will be able to come forward that didn't already know about this, that did actually see Jack, or does actually maybe know something more that can lead investigators to any more answers, because I think that he does deserve that, you know, and his family deserves that, to have some sort of closure. But yes, so I really hope that you all enjoyed this episode, my first true crime mystery. I enjoyed it. It was very interesting. I still have more, of course. Tomorrow's video will also be true crime, also from Unsolved Mysteries, the next episode, and it's, whew, it's its own can of worms, let me tell you, girl. So look out for that. But if you did enjoy this video, please make sure to give it a big, big like. I really appreciate that. That means that I should continue making videos like this, and you know, if you give me that like, I will please you. I promise you will see more of it in the future, okay? And of course, please, please do consider subscribing to my channel. It really means a lot. I have a lot of mysteries and unexplainable content of all kinds, but I also have other content as well. So there is plenty of content for any mood that you happen to find yourself in. All right, so who doesn't love that? So make sure you hit that subscribe button. I release multiple new videos every single week. Click the post notification so you can get notified whenever I do post. And yeah, guys. That is it for this episode. I really hope that you enjoyed it. Thank you so, so much for watching. I'm sending you all of the good energy and good vibes in the world, and I will see you on the next one. Bye!